Paul and Barnabas had been sharing the gospel with many people, including Gentiles. But some people in the church began to teach that the Gentiles could not be saved unless they first followed some of the same rules the Jews followed. Paul and Barnabas disagreed, and the church leaders decided to meet in Jerusalem to talk about whether or not the Gentiles needed to obey the law of Moses. After a long discussion, Peter stood up and said to the group, "Brothers, God chose me to tell the good news to the Gentiles. They heard the good news and they believed. God accepted them and gave them the Holy Spirit, just as he did for us. Why are you trying to make salvation harder for them? We know that we cannot obey God's laws perfectly. No, we believe that the Jews and Gentiles are saved in the same way, by the grace of the Lord Jesus." Everyone in the group was quiet as Paul and Barnabas told them about all the things God had done through them when they were with the Gentiles. Then another apostle, James, spoke up. He pointed out that the words of the prophet showed that God wanted to save both Jews and Gentiles. "I think we should not cause trouble for the Gentiles who have trusted in Jesus. Instead, let's write them a letter telling them the things they should not do." So the church leaders wrote a letter to the Gentile believers, explaining some things they should not do now that they were believers. The leaders chose Judas and Silas to go to Antioch and Paul and Barnabas to deliver the letter. The believers in Antioch were encouraged by the letter. Judas and Silas stayed away with them for a while, and then they went home. Paul and Barnabas stayed in Antioch, where they taught believers and told other people the good news about Jesus. The church leaders met in Jerusalem to answer a tough question. Can a person be saved by faith alone, or is something more needed? The early church agreed that because of Jesus' death and resurrection, he alone is all we need to be saved.
City Line kids, good to see you this morning. Thanks for checking in. Maybe it's in the afternoon. Maybe it's in the evening. But whenever you're watching, we are glad you are watching. Hey, don't forget, we do this live every Sunday morning. And so I want you to get to church as soon as you can, because we have a lot of fun at 9 and 11:15 every Sunday. Hey, I hope that you're ready to hear something exciting from the Bible today. But before we do that, let me ask you a really good question. I'm wondering, what's your favorite sport? Well, let me ask you this. What's the best sport? Is it baseball? Or do you like soccer? Or do you like football? Or maybe it's racing? Or maybe you like to run? Or whatever it could be. What is your favorite sport? You know, your favorite sport is probably a sport that you like watching. I know that there's only really one sport out there. Yeah, the only sport that really matters is baseball, right? And when it comes down to teams, there's really only one team that matters. And of course, it's the Chicago Cubs. Do you agree with that? Do you think that that's the only team in baseball? You know, I heard people actually like the Dodgers, and some people like the Yankees. Wow, I don't know how you can like those people, because that's not a good team. The best team is the Chicago Cubs. But see, we probably disagree. Hey, wait a second. What about ice cream flavor? What kind of ice cream flavor do you like? Just ask everybody around right now who's sitting there with you what their favorite ice cream flavor is. Well, if you had three people there, you probably came up with three different flavors, right? Yeah, because there's only really one flavor that matters, though. The best flavor is, you got it, mint chocolate chip. Yeah, that's the best flavor there is. You don't like mint chocolate chip? That's crazy. You really need to try it, because that is absolutely the best flavor there is. Mint chocolate chip. I hope you're ready for it. Hey, you see, we always disagree on things sometimes, like sports and ice cream flavors, and maybe what your favorite color is. Do you have a favorite color? Oh, I know. There's a lot of people that think pink's their favorite color. Is pink your favorite color? Or how about purple? Some people like green. I'm kind of a green guy, you know. I like a dark green kind of color. That's kind of my favorite color. Or maybe yellow. But that's about it. Those are the only two colors that matter. Green and yellow, right? Isn't that right? I mean, if you use any other color, they're just no good. But see, you have your preference as to what color you like. And so sometimes we disagree. Well, that happens today every day. We all disagree. But you know what? It happened a long time ago in the Bible, too. If you check out the 15th chapter of Acts, you will see a whole lot of disagreement. Now, what have we been talking about every day? Well, we've been talking about how the Jews were getting saved, but not only the Jews, right? Who else was getting saved in Bible times? You got it. The Gentiles. The Gentiles were being saved. And you know, Jews and Gentiles were very, very different. They really were. They were different. Jews were, you know, they had their own set of rules, and they believed they had to do certain things in order to be saved. But the Gentiles were being told about the gospel. Yeah, from Paul. And you know him, right? Barnabas. They were traveling all around and they were telling everybody about the gospel. And there were a lot of people that said, these Gentiles aren't following the rules. They're not doing what the Jews are doing every day. The Jews had a long list of rules, like they couldn't work on the Sabbath. They couldn't even, I mean, if you were a tailor, you were a Jewish tailor, and you carried a needle in your pocket on the Sabbath, guess what? You'd be in trouble. You'd be fined because that would be like working. All you have to do is carry the needle. You don't even have to be doing anything. They had all kinds of rules, things they could eat, things they could do, things they couldn't do. And they wanted to do all these things in order to be saved. And the Gentiles weren't doing these things. They didn't really follow the same rules. Now, we all have things that really there are important, right? We can't be doing a lot of these things. If we're Christian, we should want to live for Christ. But in order to get saved, in order to be a Christian, in order to live for Him, we don't have to follow all kinds of rules like the Jews did. We don't have to eat certain things. Nope. Doesn't matter what flavor of ice cream you like. Really doesn't matter. You don't have to act a certain way. You just have to act what is best to show others that Christ is in you. You have to live what Christ tells us to do, and nobody else. But salvation comes from Christ alone. So here was Paul and Barnabas, and Paul, he got up in the Jerusalem Council because this problem in Acts was so big of a problem, they brought everybody together and they decided to have a meeting. Well, that's what happens when there's a problem, right? It happens now in the church. It happened then in the church. You have a meeting. Maybe you have a family meeting. You know, you get together and you talk over some things that have been going on and how you can change them. Well, this is the same thing. It's a family meeting. That's right. So what happened was, this is exactly what it was. They got together and Paul got up and he made a speech. He said, you know what you're doing? you're making it harder on the Gentiles. We have been telling the Gentiles about Jesus. We have been giving them the gospel. And this is what we believe. We believe that Jews and Gentiles are saved in the same way. Not by the things you do, but by Jesus Christ alone, by grace. That means we don't deserve it, but we get it, even though we don't deserve it. By grace. Wow. You know, when the Jerusalem Council heard that speech, everyone was very quiet. You could hear a tailor's needle drop. It was very quiet. They listened. And Paul said, don't make salvation harder for them. Instead, understand that we're all saved in the same way. So what do you need to be saved? You need the grace of Jesus Christ. That's all you need. Jesus is really all you need. Isn't that right? Absolutely. And so this is what they decided in that big meeting. They said, I think we should send the Gentiles a letter. And we should let them know exactly what they shouldn't do now that they're saved. Because there's things you shouldn't do, right? You know, when we're saved, you know, we shouldn't disobey. That's not good. We really need to believe, right? We shouldn't have disbelief. When we're saved, we shouldn't be mean. We shouldn't have a bad attitude. We shouldn't want to fight with people. We shouldn't get angry. We shouldn't do things that would help salvation or that would cause salvation to be harder for others. I really like what Paul told the Jewish council. Because sometimes we make salvation hard for people. I know I do. Because they look at me and they know I go to church. And guess what? They see that I have a bad attitude. Or I just called them a name. Or I just made fun of them. Or I just said, hey, you know what? Get away from me. And they say, you go to church? Well, if you're going to church, I don't want anything. I don't want any part of that. I don't want to be like that. But when I reach out to people and love them the way Christ told me to love them and care for them and I'm kind, then maybe salvation will be easier for them. Yep, check it out. So we all live together in one big house. And, you know, you've got the Jews and you got the Gentiles and you got good old Paul. And this is what Paul said. He said, we ought to have faith in one another. This is what we have to realize. It's not about rules. It's about understanding that we're all the same. The Jews, the Gentiles, everybody. It's true. We are really all the same. Isn't that right? Absolutely. Absolutely true. So here's Paul. He's talking to the Jerusalem counselor, and he said, we've got the Jews over here. Now, that's not good, but we still love the Jews, and they're saved too, right? But then we've got the Gentiles right over here. We love the Gentiles, and we keep saying that they're saved too. They understood the gospel, and they knew exactly what it meant to be saved. But then we say, you're not really saved because you need more than just Jesus. You need a bunch of rules. Check it out. We got red on top. That's the Gentiles. We got Paul right here in the center, and there's the Jews, green on the bottom. Okay, now watch real close because I'm going to change the Jews and the Gentiles' place. Ready? Here we go. Hey, how about that? Pretty good, right? Green right up here on top. Now yellow in the center and red right on the bottom. You ready? Here we go. I can do it again. Watch. All you have to say is the magic words. Check it out. You see it? Whoa, huh? That's pretty good. I didn't fool you, did I? No. you know that I'm just flipping it around, right? Absolutely, you do. And Paul was saying, we can't fool one another. We can't do it. Salvation comes from Jesus alone, from grace. So he sent that letter, remember? And the Gentiles read the letter. And the letter wasn't mean. It wasn't bad. It just said, we're all saved. Now let's act like Christians. Let's act like we're saved. Let's act like Jesus is in us and not some other rule or something that doesn't matter. But let's live for Jesus and treat each other kindly. You know what? That letter encouraged. Yep. It encouraged the Gentiles. That's pretty cool. And they realized that they were all one. Whoa! How about that? Isn't that cool? That is cool. We are all one in Jesus, and I think that is pretty cool. So it's time to change our attitude, because I don't want to make salvation harder for anyone. You know, there's a difference between givers and takers. There's a difference between winners and losers, and it's not the scores. You see, givers, yeah, they say, I can. I can do it. What about you? Takers say, I want. They say, give it to me. I want it. I want it. I tell you, I don't want to be a giver. I don't want to be a taker. I don't want to say, I want. I want to say, I can. And I know through Jesus that I can do all things through him, because he strengthens me. He's the one that saved me. I got a can right here, and check it out. My can has a lid. And I want to tell you something. There's a difference in our attitude today. Some of us, we like to be angry and complain about our circumstances. Others, some of us, we don't want to do that. If we live for Christ, we're not doing that. We're changing our circumstances. We realize we can do everything through Christ. Everything. And so we're going to pray to him and give our request. Some of us, we like to read the Bible, and we like to find out more about Jesus. Even if we read just a verse a day, others of us, we're pretty lazy. We watch more TV and we just forget about the Bible. We don't even know it's there. It's collecting dust on our shelf. Some of us realize we have possibilities in our life. We can do so much if we're only inviting others, helping others, and giving them a chance. We dream about helping others. Other people expect others to fulfill their dreams. They say, I need your help. I want your help. I can't do it alone. I want you to do it for me. But Jesus said, he'll give us the strength to meet those needs. Some of us can be angry and mean, and we don't say the right things sometimes, and we're even a little jealous, you know what I mean? Others of us, we work those things out. And if there's a problem, we try to solve those problems. Wow, we got a lot of stuff here. There's a difference between saying I can and I want. Some of us live for Jesus every day, right? And some of us only come to church on Sunday or live for Jesus once in a while. We don't bring him to school, and we don't bring him outside when we're playing. And we don't bring him where we don't feel we need him. But Jesus says, I'm with you always. Wherever you go, that's where I am. So I got a question for you today. Do you want to be a giver or a taker? Do you want to say, I can, or do you want to say, I want? You see, there's a big difference. Givers will always get so much from Jesus. So if you want to be a giver, check it out. You can turn all your frustrations, problems, and all of those things into something amazing. Now, hang on. I'm not saying you're going to get paid. No, we don't get money for being a giver, but we get blessings. And we get encouragement, and we get strength, and we get answers to some of our biggest problems when we invite Christ to be part of our life. And what about those takers? The people that say, I want, where do they end up? Where they end up right here on their can, very, very empty. So what do you want to be today, a giver or a taker? I hope you realize there's a difference, and I hope you don't make salvation harder for somebody else. Wow, it's time to be together and live for Christ and know that Jesus is all you need. Jesus, thank you so much for loving us today, for living in our lives, for helping us with everything we do. I pray that we will be the ones that can go out and tell others about you, that we will not make salvation harder for anybody else, but that we will love others and that we will obey and that we will do the things that we're supposed to do and not worry about things that we're not supposed to do, but that we'll put you first in everything. Be with us today. Be in our families, help our brothers and our sisters, our parents and our family members. And Lord, help us to be your servants wherever we go. And always remember that you're with us and you're with us wherever we go forever. We pray these things today in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, we'll see you later, guys. Thanks. See you around. Bye-bye.
Hey there, I'm Pastor Brian, and it's time for Questions from Kids. Nolan from Warwick, Rhode Island asks,
I heard someone teach something about Jesus that I had never heard before. How do I know if it was true?
That is a fantastic question, and it's so important, not just for kids, but for adults as well. Because there are times we hear something, we hear a teaching or something like that, and we say, we've never heard this before. And especially if it sounds really neat, if it sounds good, we want to latch onto it and say, all right, I want to believe this and so forth. But I'm so glad that you have the ability to stop and recognize, wait a minute, I need to test what I hear before I just blindly accept it. Well, the answer is this, it's the Bible. Anything we hear taught, we should test against the Bible. Is it supported in the Bible? Now, if the person taught you something and they didn't use the Bible at all, I would be a little bit cautious. I'd want to hear that person teaching me from the Bible and showing me from the Bible what they're teaching is true. But even if they do that, you want to be sure to test it against the Bible, what you know the Bible says. And the best way to do that is for you to be regularly reading God's Word on your own. You don't want to just wait and set your Bible aside, and then if something you hear, you want to find out if it's true, you open your dusty Bible and find out if it's true or not. No, it's better for you to be in the Bible on a regular basis, so you can know truth, so you can develop a love for God based on spending time with Him in His Word. And then when you hear something new that's taught, you're more familiar with it, and you can dive a little bit more deeper to find out and test what you've heard to see if it's true or not. So test it against God's Word. Another great opportunity for you is go to talk to some other leaders and believers who you trust, your parents, for example. Go to them and say, hey, I heard this. What do you think? Have a great discussion talking about it and learning together. And maybe together you go to God's Word and test it and see what does God's Word say about it. So it's a great adventure that we're on, this adventure of growing in our faith. But make sure that you test everything against God's Word, the Bible. So here's a question back for you. What time can you set aside each day to read the Bible for yourself?
Judge is my defense, I'm going free. Right when the gavel fell, I heard the freedom that went through the Nation.